Hi everyone, thank you to be here. I'm happy to be back because this morning I was speaking about CI/CD on Google Cloud, and this afternoon I will be very happy to talk with you about data pipeline orchestration, of course Google Cloud, and how to do that with cloud workflows. I'm Guillaume Lacquière, I'm Google Developer Expert on Google Cloud. And that's why I'm speaking about Google Cloud, especially because I'm good at Google Cloud and not for the other cloud providers. I'm also data architect at Carrefour. Carrefour is a large retail company in France. So, to speak about workflows, events, event-driven, and all the orchestration of the things, we need to think about the event-driven patterns and the magic, the promise that all the cloud providers make to us. In fact, you simply have to go to the documentation, to the official documentation of Google Cloud, for example. I'm sure you'll find the same thing in other cloud providers. I can share you this presentation. You have a lot of icons if you want to make great presentation. You have all the icons of the Google Cloud product, and it's great. You have also on the bottom some reference design that you can use. I think the 69, something like that. Yes. This one, for example, is a great example of what would you do with event-driven, and it will be also the use case that I would like to present to you, because I implemented something similar in my previous company in France. In fact, here you have some devices. You have events, messages that come from devices to a gateway to group all the messages, and the gateway forwards the messages to the to Google Cloud. Here it's through PubSub. In our case, it would be through Cloud Storage, because the files are uploaded by the gateway to cloud storage, but we'll see that just after. And then you have you have some arrow like that to transmit the messages from one place to the other one. And there is something magic, because the arrow say you have one event, one message, and magically it go to the other place. And here you have a data flow, we have a lot of stuff. You can process the data with analytics, perform machine learning, and serve your data with App Engine or Quant Engine or Compute Engine. You can go to the other slides if you want. For example, here you have data, and data can be processed by Hadoop, Beam, or other app, and store back one way and to the other way. So it's magic. It's only some arrow to put. And here again, you have messages, files, or streaming data that are processed by data flow, and then the data go to storage location and then are processed in real time or not by product. The arrows are very powerful, and it's sometimes a trap. That's why I would like to demonstrate that there is maybe something better to do. So let me go back to the full screen. Yeah. So we'll take a simple use case in my previous company where we had some IoT devices. I think I have one here. To see it in the camera. Here I have it's a water meter. The water meter here, and on top you have devices that can send with this antenna messages to a gateway to send all the messages and all the water consumption of the users. So the gateway take the messages and upload a file on cloud storage. When the file is uploaded, we have to process, unpack, decipher the data with data flow, and then to store the data in BigQuery because it's our enterprise data warehouse. That's the first step. The second step, we have to extract the data. At the end of the data flow, we have to extract the new data, and to load those new data to Cloud SQL. Why we are doing that? Because BigQuery is perfect for enterprise data warehouse and for processing large amount of data, petabyte of data in few seconds. But for real-time website, where you want only to get a few data on your website, in fact, you need to have a low-latency database. And BigQuery is not a low-latency database. BigQuery, it's an analytics data warehouse. And when you start a query on BigQuery, you have to wait 500 milliseconds or 1 second to warm up and to provision the compute on BigQuery. And this latency is huge when you talk about a website. Imagine you have to click to wait 1 second to have the data back, to click again to wait 1 second. It's too slow. That's why we duplicate the data from BigQuery to Cloud SQL by performing also some aggregation for a better visualization on the website. The second step is also at the end of the data flow, we would like to perform aggregation and to store them back to Cloud SQL. Why? Because when you talk about water, you need to know the consumption of one user, the primary usage, but also the consumption of one area or one city to understand what the behavior of the consumer, but also the status of the network, because you know how many water, the volume of water that you put in the pipe, you know the consumption of the users and the difference between the consumption and what you put in input of the pipes. You have the leakage of your network. That's why it's also important to perform aggregation for the back office. And then we'll serve the website on App Engine. This process is very simple. You have a file in you have a file on Cloud Storage. You process the file, store the data in BigQuery, and then extract the data from BigQuery and store them in Cloud SQL. We try to implement that with Google Cloud. And before doing that, I would like to explain you what are the event-driven components on Google Cloud, because you have different types. When you talk about event-driven, you have the event producer to generate the event and the event consumer to consume and to get the event and to consume them and to perform actions on events. If you have a look to the event producer, I will say nicely, because after we have something like a hack that we can do. We have the Cloud Native Events, and I think it will be the only one. It's the legacy Cloud, Cloud Native Events with Firestore and Cloud Storage that are able to directly trigger other products on Google Cloud. But generally, when you use events on Google Cloud, you use PubSub. PubSub, it's a publisher subscriber channel. It's a queue, in fact, like Kafka, if you know Kafka. It's the same thing. You have some producers that publish messages and some consumers that read messages in subscriptions. That's all. And you have for now about 8 products directly connected and able to directly generate messages to PubSub. You have Cloud Storage to say when a new file has been created, Secret Manager when a new version of a secret has been done, Cloud Build when you have an alert on your billing because you reach a threshold and you have a message that you can publish on PubSub. You have Cloud Alerting again when you have an alert on your project. It's not a threshold on the billing, but an alert, business alert. You have Cloud Scheduler able to periodically publish message on PubSub. Security Command Center, when a threat is detected on Security Command Center, you can publish a message and then do what you want on this alert. Cloud Build, when a build is done, you have the status of the build that is published on PubSub, maybe to notify the development team if the build has been okay or not on Slack, for example. And then you have BigQuery. BigQuery is not the whole BigQuery, it's a schedule queries on BigQuery that are able to publish the status of the scheduled queries on PubSub. Only 8 products for now. It's too few for the whole platform of Google Cloud. That's why there is a trick to produce more events on more products. And you have something like a hack to do that. And you have, in fact, cloud logging. What is it? You have logs. Your application generates logs, generates the business log, application logs, but also audit logs. And on these logs, you can create a sync. That means it's a filter. You filter the log entry that you want. And the log entries are published, sync, somewhere in cloud storage, in PubSub, or in BigQuery. That allows you to get your data where you want. And of course, in our case, what is interesting is the PubSub solution, because when you have an event on cloud logging, whatever the product, whatever the events on your application that generate a special logs, you can filter these logs and publish a message in PubSub, then to perform subsequent action if you want. Event arc. In this picture, in fact, you have it's not really a hack, but it's not very nice and very easy to do. And event arc has been released, I think, 1 or 2 years ago. And event arc, it's a nicer way to generate event and to manage the events. In fact, behind the scene, it's exactly the same thing. You will listen the logs, sync the log in PubSub topic, and create a PubSub subscription to call. Up to now, it was only Cloud Run, but now you have also Cloud Function second generation that you can invoke with an event with Event Arc, and you have also Cloud Workflow that you can invoke with Event Arc. In fact, Cloud Workflow, you can invoke Cloud Workflow with a PubSub message, with a PubSub subscription. And because Event Arc use PubSub to deliver the events, of course, Cloud Workflow is also compliant. New products are compliant with Event Arc. I recently showed that GKE services are also compliant. GKE, it's a Kubernetes, is the managed Kubernetes on Google Cloud, Google Kubernetes Engine. You can also invoke GKE services now with Event Arc if you want. That was for the producer part. Now you have to consume the events, and you have two ways to consume them. The first one is to consume the cloud native events, and you have only the cloud function first generation that are able to consume these native events, the cloud storage event and the cloud Firestore events. But for all the other events, and even for these native events, you have HTTP. HTTP, in fact, is the solution to deliver messages to any services. Why this pattern? Because at Google Cloud, all is API. All the interaction with the product are API, and your design must be also API and receive HTTP request to perform operation. So with PubSub, but also with Cloud Task or Cloud Scheduler, you can generate HTTP request and call the services that you want. You can call, of course, Cloud Run, App Engine, Cloud Function. You can also call Cloud Build, GKE, Compute Engine, and even Cloud Workflow now. I forgot to add this here. So you can call any services able to receive an HTTP request, and even other services like Cloud Build and Cloud Workflow that are able to understand an HTTP request. So that's a pretty simple way to invoke any services with HTTP at the end. So now, go back to our use case, and here it was the proposition. Just a reminder, you have a file coming from gateway. The gateway upload a file on cloud storage. When the file come in, we trigger a cloud data flow. The data flow run, and when the data flow is over, we would like to export data from BigQuery to cloud SQL, and also to perform aggregation in BigQuery and to export the result to cloud SQL, and then to expose the data on our website through App Engine. Now, how to implement that in the reality? We forgot the magic euro and how to do that, but what's the reality now? The first version of our implementation was this one. In fact, cloud storage can't trigger directly cloud workflow. You have to catch the event and to perform a call to start data flow. For that, you have to create a cloud function that gets the events of the new file that's come in cloud storage, and then to invoke data flow. It's not so difficult to do, but you need to know that to invoke data flow, you need to create a data flow template, and then to invoke this template with the correct parameters. But okay, we have one cloud function to do that. Then the second operation is to say, when the cloud data flow is over, I would like to extract the newest data from BigQuery and to sync the data in cloud SQL, in our low latency database. This time it's more difficult. Why? Because there is no events published by data flow when data flow is over. We need to listen the logs and to understand when data flow is over, and when data flow is over, to sync the logs in PubSub, then to plug a cloud function, for example on PubSub, or maybe on cloud run if you want. What do this cloud function? This cloud function say, hey BigQuery, can you export the data to cloud storage? So the data are exported to cloud storage, and when this operation is done, cloud function say to cloud SQL, hey cloud SQL, can you import the data stored in a cloud storage in a table in a cloud SQL? So now it's a pretty complex. You have to follow all the events, so when the events are triggered, when the events are catch, what's happened if you have one issue. You get in the logs the end of the data flow. You don't know if the data flow is in relation with the file that you received just before. It's maybe a data flow more longer because you received a large file 1 hour before. So it's really tricky to implement that, but in the happy path, it works. All the edge cases are difficult to manage. Now, step three, we would like to perform aggregation and to store the aggregation in cloud SQL. So this time, because it's aggregation, we chose to use schedule queries in BigQuery. And we, at the end of the schedule queries, we have a message published in PubSub. It's quite easy. And so on PubSub, we plug a cloud function that performs a query in BigQuery and insert the result in cloud SQL. Why no cloud storage this time? Because it's aggregation, the volume of data is low, and we have no need to export the data in cloud storage and then to import them in cloud SQL. It's okay to get the data in the memory of cloud function and to load the data in cloud SQL. So that's over, and then we serve the data on App Engine. No events here, no special things to do here. It's over. So between the reality, between the proposition and the reality, you can see that the event magic is not so magic. But we can simplify the thing because here it's really the mess. In my opinion, it's the mess because we have events in any directions. The mess because it's difficult to monitor, to trace what's happened in the system. there are difficult to track, and when you want to perform a retry or to resume on an error, it's difficult to start as in the real to have the same state that before in your application. It's very difficult to track and to retry. You also don't know when the world transaction is over. A file come in, a data flow is over. If the data flow is in relation with the file, you don't know. You have an event, the data flow is over, and that's all. The business flow is also blurry, not clear. When you have a newcomer in your team, you have many services, many events, and you have a process, but you don't see clearly what's the purpose of each part of your process. Or you have to document that, but sometimes the documentation is not up to date, so it's difficult. When you deploy one service, one cloud function, one cloud run, how to perform the rollout and the rollback? Do you release all the things at the same time? Do you release one cloud function by one cloud function? If one cloud function, you can't deploy it because you have an issue, why do you roll back? Do you roll back only one cloud function? Do you roll back all the cloud function? Yes, you have also this to take into account, because sometimes the dependencies are strong. And finally, how to test and ensure the non-regression of your system. That could be a challenge because it's answer only to events, and you have to generate events to simulate API paths and issues. So you have a lot of issues with this event driven and this solution, and you want to make order in this mess. And the solution is to use an orchestrator like a workflow, to have something in the middle, to have the brain of your workflow to orchestrate and to call the correct service at the right time. You can use Cloud Workflow to call GCP services, but also APIs. As I said, all these APIs at Google Cloud and at Google in general. If you can call GCP services, that means you can call APIs internal or external. It's serverless, nothing to manage, nothing to patch, nothing to install, only to describe, to declare your workflow. Again, serverless, it's a pay per use. You pay each step of your workflow and you have a free tier, very high. I think you have millions of steps as free tier. It's hard to pay at the beginning with a cloud workflow. You can describe your workflow with YAML or JSON, according to your preferences. And yes, as I said, you can access to internal and external APIs. You have many main features of workflow because you have to define, to describe what you want to do. You have a function that you can use in your workflow to transform string, to transform that, to parse them. You have some loops and iteration to iterate over an array, for example. You have some decision step, a switch case. In this condition, where I can jump to this step. In this condition, I can jump to another step, etc. I can perform loops also to go back to a previous step if I want. You have a built-in error and handling. That means if you have an error when you invoke an API, you have a 404 or you have a 401. It's a two different type of issue. A 404, maybe you can retry later if your file is not yet here. No problem, you can retry on a 404. On 401, if you are not authorized, it's not authorized. You must request your administrator to have the permission to perform the operation. So on two different error codes, you can have two different actions. Either you retry after a while, or you exit in error because if it's a permission error, you can do anything. And even if you wait, you won't be able to access to the resource. You have also built-in authentication for Google Cloud products, because when you access to Google Cloud products, you need to be authentified and to provide a token, the identity of the service account of the workflow. And you can customize this service account, and you can generate automatically, at the end, it's a workflow that generates automatically a token to access to Google Cloud products. And you also have connectors that simplify the call to some APIs, especially when the APIs are asynchronous. The connectors will wait for you and perform the loop internally to wait the end of the asynchronous call. For example, like a data flow, you start a data flow and automatically the connector will wait for you the end of the data flow before continuing the process in a cloud workflow. You can have initialization variables at the beginning of your workflow, and you can set these variables externally. That means you can invoke the same workflow but with different variables to perform the same thing but not with the same context, maybe to access to a bucket in production and bucket in development. It's the same workflow, but the variables, the bucket is not the same, for example. Another powerful feature is the capacity to reuse the result of a previous step in the subsequent step. Maybe you can perform an API call, I don't know, to get the weather in a city by an API call. You get the result, and this result, you can inject it, I don't know, maybe in BigQuery, if you want to log the weather in a city or something like that. You can reuse the result of previous step very easily. And because you can call API, you can call internal API, but you can call external APIs. As I said, for example, a weather API. Of course, this time, you don't have authentication support for external API, but you can code and add the headers required for authentication for external APIs. A quick overview of what the console on Google Cloud. You have on one side a code editor with auto-completion, and on the right-hand side, you have the workflow and the different steps that you can visualize and have your business flow graphically appear. Of course, this diagram won't tell you that your workflow will work, but if you want to insert a step in a special place in your workflow, you can do that easily because you can see in the chart if your update inserts correctly at the right position the new process that you want to perform. So now go back to our use case and try to perform the same thing with Cloud Workflow and an orchestrator instead of to have an event-driven solution where events pop anytime, anywhere, and without any management or order. So same thing, we have a cloud storage, we have a file that's come in cloud storage, and because it's new, I just update here the schema, is the capacity to invoke data flow with event arc, workflow with event arc. You have a new file, you start a workflow, and it's event arc that performs the link between the two. No code to write, nothing to upload, it's only configuration, and say on that bucket, I listen all the events, and when a new file comes in, I will trigger my workflow. When the workflow runs, we have all our steps. First steps, I would like to invoke data flow. We use connectors. And data flow will process the data of the file and then sync the data in BigQuery. When the data flow is over, you have an event back to workflow, and workflow will trigger the second step, that is to get the data from BigQuery and to sync the data in cloud storage. Okay, it's only a query to BigQuery. It's an export statement. When the query on BigQuery is over, again, workflow is notified. And the third step can be done. Not the third step, the second part of the step. That means you have to import in Cloud SQL the data exported in Cloud Storage. So third step on Cloud Workflow, call Cloud SQL API with the correct parameters with the file in Cloud Storage and import the data in target table in Cloud SQL. Now we have a third step. The third step is to perform, in fact, the same thing, to perform a query in BigQuery for aggregation and to load the result in Cloud SQL. With workflow, a cool feature that exists is named sub-workflow. In fact, you can factorize, you can export that extract in a function, if you want, like a function in your code. You can extract a series of steps in sub-workflow and simply to re-invoke the same sub-workflow but with different parameters. For the third step, in fact, you have to invoke the same thing. I would like to perform a query in BigQuery, also an export statement, but this time with aggregation to aggregate the data and to export the data in cloud storage, but the cloud storage is not the same, it's another bucket, it's not the same as the previous one. And you want to load the data in cloud SQL again, but it's not the same table, target table, it's another one. In fact, it's only three parameters at the beginning of the third sub-workflow, a new query, a new bucket, and a new table in cloud SQL. But you reuse the same logic internally in cloud workflow. And of course, at the end, when the data are in Cloud SQL, you serve your data in with App Engine. So the process is much more simpler, and you don't have to know if you have a look here. You don't have to know how to manage the logs, how to manage PubSub, how to manage Cloud Function, how to deploy them. You have only to deploy Cloud Workflow and Workflow operate and orchestrate all the API calls that you want to perform and all the operations that you want to perform. You have a lot of benefits by doing that. The first is a central point of control. If something going wrong, you have only to have a look to Cloud Workflow, to the logs of Cloud Workflow, and you understand where the problem is and at which step the problem occurred and to reply on this step. You have also a business logic graph automatically in the console. Even if you develop on your computer and you invoke the gcloud command to load your workflow, you can go back to the console and edit your workflow and you have the business logic graph on the right. You can copy paste it if you want, add it to your documentation. It's very easy to perform. Because it's easy to perform and to add this business logic to your documentation, the workflow now become easy to understand for anybody, for the newcomer. Because it's easier to understand, it's also easier to debug because you know what's happened at which step, at which stage of your process, the debug is easier. And again, because you know easily what you do in your workflow, it's easy to add a step, to add a fork or a hook in your business logic to extend it and to have more features on the raw workflow and the raw business logic. You have, as I said just before, no additional component to add, to learn, to manage, to be expert on them, because when you want to use cloud logging with a sync to PubSub and then to invoke a cloud function, it's not so easy for the newcomer on Google Cloud. It's serverless, my preferred part. I have nothing to manage. I'm only the user of the service. And in addition, you have a free tier, so you can use it and test it. It's very very easy and very pleasant to use. And yes, that's all for me. Just a last word about Cloud Workflow. It's a product that evolves very quickly. The team is very dynamic, and you have a lot of evolution. For example, for now, you can query the... Yeah, okay. I'm here again. Yeah, you can query your logs, and you can know which step is running on Cloud Workflow, because up to now, you had only the start and the end of your workflow, but not the different step. But now you can have the status of the advancement of your workflow, and on at which steps is the current workflow, the current execution of the workflow. So that's all for me. Thank you for your attention and being here with me. You can find me on Twitter. I will share the slides on Twitter also. You can reach me now if you have some questions. You can reach me later on GitHub, Medium, Twitter, LinkedIn, wherever you want. And we'll be happy to answer your questions, especially on the workflow, because I like this product and I'm sure it will be a strong product in the future. And so I will just have a check on the question if you have some. No question for now. So no problem. Thank you again and have a great day, and I'm happy to answer your questions later on social network. Thank you very, very, very much. Goodbye.